So I've been wanting to do a review in this style for this album for a pretty long time now. Pretty much ever since I heard it, I really wanted to dive into the lore of this record. And I decided that I had a really good place to start with this because right now this album, Undun by the Roots, is turning 10 years old today. I actually decided to put the record up right there for display for the video. And this is not going to be a normal review. This isn't just going to be me going through each track. There's a reason it's titled differently. What it's going to be more of is it's going to be similar to the Tip of a Butterfly video. Not as high edited because I don't have nearly the amount of time because I'm recording this the night before its birthday. So I kind of don't have the time to, you know, edit it as highly together as I did the TPAP video or TPAP series. But I do want to make a video, and I did think it would be a really cool idea to kind of really dive into the story of Undun, because this is a very deep record and has a lot to analyze lyrically, conceptually, and everything. I decided I was going to do a review on why Undun by the Roots, 10 years later, is still a masterpiece. And I'll start with kind of the general thought I want to base this on, which is really like 90s hip-hop groups, because when you kind of look in the 90s, there's a lot of some of the best, in terms of groups, there's no other era of hip hop that had as many amazing groups as the 90s. In fact, the majority of the best hip hop groups of all time, in my opinion, rose in the 90s. You had guys like the Wu-Tang Clan, A Tribe Called Quest, Outkast, Bone Thugs and Harmony, Mobb Deep. Well, a couple of those are duos, you get my point. All just amazing groups, all just amazing collectives who have all classics and just amazing projects. But one group, you guys know I love them, has always stood out to me is The Roots. And what makes The Roots such a great group and such a great hip-hop collective to me is the two concepts, that the fact that they have a live band in their backing, which means that their music just sounds more like expressive and lively. It feels a lot more layered and deeper than just normal studio recordings. There are real drums being played. There are real guitars. There are real keyboards. There's so much more individual talent versus one producer doing everything or such. And it results in every single thing The Roots does sounding amazing in terms of their production, in terms of the sound. It always sounds amazing. And on top of that, they have one of the greatest rappers of all time as their lead rapper, Black Thought. Black Thought is always considered among the top 20, at least maybe the top 10 greatest rappers of all time. His lyricism, his rhyme schemes, his storytelling, just really everything he does is seriously makes him one of the most impressive hip-hop artists, I think, of all time. And I think he's never had a bad moment in his career, and Black Thought is easily one of my all-time favorite rappers. But for me, a lot of people, there's not really a definitive of what the best Roots record is, but for me, I don't actually think it came until the 2010s, until Undun came out. They definitely had classics before this. Things Fall Apart, Ill Adolf, Half-Life, Game Theory, The Tipping Point, Rising Down, what's Phrenology. There's so many amazing records that they put out before this. But for me, there's just no other album they have that's as well put together as Undun, as conceptually well put together, as beautiful, as deep, as personal, as real. In general, Undun just is it's a very quick record. It only is 38 minutes, but that is what I feel like makes it so good, as it kind of just is able to bring all these concepts in a really quick format. And the sonically, it's amazing, and it never skips and it never slacks on any track. The general plot of this, it's a story album, so the general plot of it is this character named Redford Stevens. Now, Redford is a young black man who has been born into poverty, and it's pretty much all he's ever known. Crime and that life is really all he's ever known growing up in this world. It basically, the story is similar to Damn, where it's kind of this reverse album where it tells from the end of the story to the beginning. It's his suicide and how that came to be, how his life of crime and being enthralled, and it really led him to the dark place of suicide. I feel like in terms of story records, this is one of the coolest stories I think hip-hop's ever told, because I think it's really fascinating how it moves forward and how you get to experience it. And it's pretty much separated into the parts of 10 solid tracks that make up this story, and then you're given 4 final tracks that kind of add their own concepts, add their own twists and whatnot. But without further ado, let's get into why I feel like The Roots' masterpiece and the greatest record they've put out, and why, in my opinion, it is still a timeless record 10 years later. Let's talk about Undun by The Roots. Undun opens off on a very distorted, low-key, but very real note. It opens with the track Done, which is a kind of this, it's just this instrumental piece done, I think, by Questlove. I don't know, but I think that's what I read. Don't quote me on that though. Undun is really focusing on this theme of life and death and birth and rebirth, and there's a reason this album's gonna open up with this ominous kind of strange instrumental and close out with its own instrumentals as well. Pretty much what the track Done represents is it kind of represents Red Ford's life after he's killed himself, going into the afterlife and going on to this new state. It's not really a track that's meant to tackle a big theme. It's really meant to set things off on this very ominous, dark note. And it kind of makes it this little bit of an otherworldly track, as you can kind of hear these vocals in the back. And it's not a very pleasant listen. It's not something I would ever listen to in any other context than this record. But it sets the album off on a very fascinating note. And it's kind of just this idea of this terrible action of committing suicide and the irreversibility of that, as we basically get to kind of listen to his journey into the afterlife. We don't really get to know where Redford's mind state was when he did this action or why it happened until the next couple tracks. But as we go, we will kind of learn more as this action of suicide has happened and how irreversible that action is, but also how it led to that action of really just ending it all. Sleep is the track where it's kind of, it's not the action of it, it's the post-mortem of that, it's the reflection of that suicide. We're given a very vivid description of Redford's mental state here. Aaron Livingston sings the hook on this in a very beautiful way, which one of my favorite things about this album is the guest hooks. Who is it? Dive Raw does some hooks on this. There's a ton of great singers who deliver just beautiful vocals on these choruses, and Aaron Livingston delivers a really beautiful hook here. I noticed something about the hook that is interesting to me, is it's not too rhythmic. I don't think I could get the chorus of Sleep in my head. I feel like I really couldn't. I can really get the track in my head, but that chorus, it's not really as direct, like, with its rhythm as other tracks. I can't really find a meaning in that, but it's an observation. There is pretty much just this track is pretty much, though, it feels like this kind of reflection on the action of suicide and basically just that moment after doing that action. The ending of the track ends with this line, which would one of my favorite lines in the entire album, which is, "And there I go from a man to a memory and wonder if my fam will ever remember me," which it feels like just this very much straightforward, he has killed himself. And first couple tracks, it is very apparent that's what's going on here. And it perfectly just brings that together and brings this terrible action to it, but in a very peaceful way. This album isn't too dramatic with any emotion. It gets emotional later in the album, which is interesting because the more intense part of this album is the beginning versus the end of the album being where it seems a lot more mellow, or where it should be more mellow, but it isn't. It gets a lot more depressing as it goes in a weird way. Sleep is a pretty nice track. It's pretty much 2 minutes straight. It's very easy to get into, and it pretty much directly tells what it needs to about Red Ford's action of killing himself. It doesn't do anything grand. It's not really one of my favorite songs, but then again, it's 10 songs, and I pretty much adore the fuck out of every one of these songs. This song is very special to me. I do really love it, and I think it perfectly brings into the idea of depression and how that leads him to the pretty much darkest outcome. Arguably one of the darkest outcomes a human can lead to by themselves, which is that doorstep of killing themselves. But you're going to get an interesting contemplation on how that should be reflected on Redford as a person on the record. It is seriously fascinating the way Black Thought wrote this album. It's mind blows me how deep it gets at some points. Make Him I, though, however, is that action. It is that moment of him killing himself. And this track is a lot more easy to get into for me. Sleep is not a track I'd listen to in any other context than the album, I'll be honest. But Make Him I, I feel like I really could. It has really a really solid feature on it. It has a feature from Big Crit, who I feel like really adds a great style to the album. It also, there's another artist, I'm forgetting what his name is. I need to find where I credit him. Oh, Dice Rod. Dice Rod is the hook on this one. And it's a very mellow hook to me, and I really love it, because it really gives this more kind of mellow idea of what suicide is. There's a line where he says, "Let me throw in the towel and make my departure from this earth." I think I didn't write that line. I just know that's how it ends. Pretty much, it's kind of the climax of the record in the reverse order it's in, if you think about it. When we're given, we'll go back to Big Crit's verse. Pretty much the whole theme of this track is we're basically, so currently right now, where we're at in Undun is we know one thing about this album. Redford killed himself. That's really all we know. We get the implication he's a criminal. That's pretty much implied in the first couple songs. But we're not really given why that action is committed. But in Make My, we're given a much more clear picture of why this action is committed and what led him here. We're given this kind of idea that it's pretty much his ultimate regret and pain of causing so much violence and so much, because in the end, being a criminal isn't going to result in a soul healing. It's not going to result in a healthy life in general. It's basically just this idea. There's a really good theme that I think Big Crit kind of brings in this verse, which is basically just this. He basically describes this paradise of living on yachts, you know, having all this money, having all this success, but never being able to relax and enjoy that because of how you moved there. You got your paradise by giving other people hell. I feel like that's a very deep idea, and I really love it. It's definitely apparent to me that the rappers on this album, Black Thought's even saying this about the record, that they really identify with the character that this Redford character that they're writing. And it's cool, I think, that Dice Raw and all the, there's tons of features on this record, and they always seem to come from the perspective of Redford. They never do something else or go on their own. Oh, here's a random side character. No. It's all from the perspective of Redford. Every single word in this album is. And that makes it really emotional to me, and it makes it really feel like it's very dedicated to this theme. But Make My pretty much just is that action of killing himself, or at least the thought process of leading up to that. There's a line in this, which might be my favorite line in the whole record. There's some lines in later on that I like more. But it's the line by Black Thought that's still in the atmosphere like airplay. If there's a heaven, I can't find the stairway, which is very much just his depiction of this is the end for him. It's a really beautiful song. It arguably is one of the saddest songs in the album, though, because it really is that raw action of suicide. But it really gets interesting as you kind of learn where this idea roots from. Hey, Roots. Sorry, that was terrible. Next, we're given One Time, which has to be one of my favorite songs in the whole album. Undoubtedly, is this one of the best songs in the whole album. One Time is a really beautiful song that really tackles the theme I feel like it wants to, which is it's a more like expanded version of this idea of remorse of crime. And there's not like a ton of remorse leading up or like that we're gonna hear later. What we're gonna hear later is more just like kind of regret of everything, but it doesn't feel like there's a ton of this like remorse of actually hurting people. And that's really what One Time is about. It's a song that's less depressing than the past couple, but then again, this album kind of crescendos in its emotion, which I think is an interesting way to kind of look at his life when we get to the end of the record. We'll talk about that more. But One Time is easily one of my favorite songs on this album. It's definitely a track where he's really coming to grips with what he's done as a person. The hook by Dice Raw is beautiful, which feels like this kind of idea of just why even try, why even keep going. He mentions this idea of why even care if you're late kind of thing. There's the line, the chorus line, which is just, if I was ever lucky, it was one time, which is just a very depressing thought. And I don't really think that idea of unluckiness is what this track is diving for. I think it's more just this idea that just, that is a very hopeless idea of just never feeling luck in your life. And a lot of this album is going to reach this really lonely, lost, hopeless state. Everything about this song I feel is amazing. The piano and the way that coincides with the drum as this kind of buildup of emotion. And on top of that, Dice Raw, just his vocalization on the hook is beautiful. I feel like it's much more easy for me to get engaged with the sound of this song than the previous couple songs. So the previous couple songs are amazing. This one I can just really get into what it's going for sonically. Overall, I actually think in terms of a song, this is probably one of my favorite Roots songs ever, at least in my top five. I fucking love this song, and I think it is a masterpiece of a song. I think it perfectly tackles the idea of hurting people and the pain that's going to cause you, and basically just this depressive state and that buildup, kind of building more and more onto why the album ends on that suicide note. When I say this album kind of is like a mountain and it kind of goes up and down in terms of its emotion, this is what I mean. Cool On is really the start of this, because this is arguably the most upbeat song on the album. This song isn't nearly as depressing as the other songs on the record and nearly as emotional, because really the idea of the track is let's celebrate life, let's celebrate our success. We're given features from Greg Porn. I mean, the album has Greg Porn, or the track has Greg Porn, Black Thought, and Truck North, which all rap about the same idea, which is just this, just kind of let's celebrate what we have the chance to celebrate, our success and our fame. We have a sample from Where There's a Will by DJ Rogers, which I think is really well done. I think it's a very simple but effective sample that gives it this very upbeat, kind of lively sound. Like I mentioned, it's much more laid back, but the song's idea, it doesn't remove the idea of remorse, but it's not him coming to grips with, it's not Redford coming to grips with the idea of remorse. It's more of him saying, I did a lot of immoral shit to get to the life I'm at and get to the success I'm at. So I'm going to celebrate before that mentality or that immortality is what takes a toll on me and takes a toll on everyone. It's interesting to look back on kind of where we've come up to this point, as his mentality seems to just deteriorate over his life. But Cool On is very much just this more laid back celebration of a track. But it doesn't seem to kind of lose this theme of remorse. It doesn't drop it so that it can be a fun track. It absolutely still commits to that. And that's what makes Cool On, I think, such an enjoyable song to me. I feel like in terms of just songs this record, it maybe isn't like a top five song on the record, but it certainly is an enjoyable track, and I do really enjoy what it brings to the table as this kind of song that successfully is fun, laid back, catchy, enjoyable, and has great features, but doesn't want to forget the fact that we are still talking about a man who's done awful things and is feeling remorse for those awful things and is still experiencing depression. Deep song, but very enjoyable song, and it's pretty listenable overall. Next, we're given easily one of my favorite tracks on the album, The Other Side, which I just think is a fantastic song, and I think it's amazing. The feature is Greg Porn, once again, who is long, if you know Roots, long friend of the Roots, has worked for them for a very long time. It also features the amazingly talented Bilal. Y'all know how much I love Bilal. I think he's a phenomenal vocalist. I love everything he does. And I love his hook on this song so much. I think in terms of the album up to this point, it's my favorite hook. He just really puts in this emotion, and he really gets to the theme it's supposed to be about, which is basically just life is short, don't really waste time, you know, don't really forget, or like don't spend your life doing things that you hate, pretty much. And that's a very enjoyable, and it's a very kind of uplifting theme, because it kind of feels like this idea of who gives fuck we do on earth, once we get to heaven's gates we'll deal with the shit we've done on earth. Which, I mean, when you really think about it, isn't a great mentality, but it's a relaxing mentality. It's a relaxing mentality to take off that morality off of you and realize, let me just focus on this later and just focus on living a good life, which is a pretty nice thought overall. I really love Black Thought and Greg's just way they tackle the theme. I think Redford has a very interesting, like, a lot of lines in this that I think are really interesting. I kind of talks about how Redford will cover up his pain with material success and wealth, which, if you know other videos that I've analyzed in the world of hip-hop, it's not rare for artists to say, I'm covering up my emotions with money, with success, with women, or with whatever. And the reason why it's so common is because it is a world of competitiveness, it is a world of flexing, but it's also a world where often trying to be the personal one trying to come out to say, hey, there's an issue in my life, is considered weakness. So basically covering that up when the material success sounds really good, but as we know, if you've watched other videos of mine, other analysis videos of mine, this is a common theme in music, that this covering up of pain just delays that pain. And when that pain comes back, it comes back worse. It's basically a method of dampening depression and saving it for later versus actually head on looking at the regrets you have and the depression you've been given and basically saying, I need to face this head on. Because I've said in other videos before, there's no really other way to tackle that theme than actually facing it head on. And a good example is spending all of your life on material wealth and trying to cover up your pain with that. But it's interesting how it's mentioned in this song, but not really focused on. It's more of just this, yeah, I know I do that and I know that's fucked up, but I'm gonna keep doing it. And it's interesting to me as this album's gonna continue to dive with the fact that I would say him covering his material wealth is part of the reason it leads to his suicide. But I once again would like to explain later why it's not really his fault, why that mentality is in his head. I really love it. I think it's one of my favorite songs on the album. Other Side is a beautiful song. The instrumental is phenomenal. And Bilal's hook is so catchy and enjoyable. Overall, easily, arguably, probably up there in my top 20 favorite Root songs of all time. Probably, maybe even top 10 if we're being honest. Stop to me is kind of, when we're talking about the peak of this record, like I mentioned, it's kind of a mountain. I'd say it starts with Cool On, peaks on the Other Side, and ends with Stomp. Because once we get to Stomp, we're gonna get to the final three tracks in this album, which are, none of them are joyful, none of them are happy listens, but they're all very powerful listens. Stomp is a very quick but effective song. It's easily the most competitive idea on this song, as it feels like it's kind of this competitive nature kind of driving him to really want to, you know, take over and have the power and be this criminal and be this kind of generally bad person. With the guitar instrumental and kind of even rock themes with it, it doesn't really seem to want to, like, it seems just like this track of I'm not going to give up, I'm going to continue to fight, which is a theme of fighting for success on this record as well. We're going to hear more about that in a later track, specifically Tip the Scale. But I love the way it's tackled on this track. We also have their very brief pregame warm-up speech by Gregoria Tech pastor Derek Moore, which is interesting to me. It's just kind of there, which is not Gregoria. What the fuck? It's Georgia. Goddamn. It's Georgia Tech pastor Derek Moore, which it's very much just him saying, we're going to keep on fighting. We're not going to back down. And it adds a very much competitive nature to the song. But it's interesting to me because you can kind of look at it and it's interesting to me because if you listen to Stomp in a context that's not Undone, it wouldn't have the same impact than the impact it has when in this album. Because you're not given the context outside of the album that this song is a earlier version of someone who's going to kill themselves over the reasoning of hurting people and crying, giving them depression. That idea in Stomp doesn't really seem to like resonate with him. It seems to be just more of this, I'm going to keep fighting. But when you look at it, his keep on fighting to gain more power, to gain more material success, is what ends up leading to his demise, which makes the song a lot harder to get hype up to because you know where this mentality leads to. You know it doesn't lead to massive success and a great life for Redford. It ends in his suicide. So it's a very impactful song when it comes to that aspect to it. And it's an interesting song to me that this album or this song would not have nearly the same ideas or impact if it was in a playlist. And that's fascinating to me. It's not one of my favorite songs, but I really enjoy it. It's competitive. It's kind of more intense, and I like it as a song. It's not one of my favorites, but I do really enjoy it for what it is. Then we're given The Lighthouse, which is easily one of my favorite songs on this record. It might be my second or third favorite. I love this song so much. Dice Raw's hook is one of my favorite hooks on this record. And on top of that instrumental, it's the perfect song to describe loneliness to me. I don't know who wrote the theme of loneliness and depression being like you being lost at sea, drowning in the ocean, and it feeling like there's no lighthouse. Because when you think about it, when you're in a boat or you are trapped at sea, the most hopeful thing you can see is the lighthouse, because it's an indication of civilization. It's an indication that there is tower people who want to help you. But when there is no lighthouse and you can just see this cold building of no one there, it's very much this indication of those people who are supposed to protect you and make sure you're okay. Yeah, they're not there right now. They don't care. And it's the perfect description of that idea. And it's also this idea of, if that lighthouse doesn't save you, you may very well drown. And the drowning and depression is what I feel like that's kind of going at. It's a very fascinating song, and it feels like really where it's coming from and really where that idea is this idea of him having lived a life of crime and him having done so many wrong things, but him not really seeing a way out, because you could argue that the theme of there not being anyone in the lighthouse is there not being any moral guide in his life other than himself. There's no, like, parent there telling you, hey, you got to go set out and do this. You got to do better. There's no really theme of that. It's just his personal destruction of him being lonely out at sea and him thinking of himself in an earlier track, Stomp, I need to dedicate myself to fight on and get out of this, which doesn't end up being what was the answer to how to get out of this loneliness. There's also, it continues on that theme of covering up pain with material wealth, which I just love the way this song tackles that. I think when it comes down to it, this song is beautiful to me. And it's another evidence on this album that it's not the writing that makes Undun as amazing as it is, which I'll talk about more later. But a lot of the sonic stuff, like in terms of the vocals and the instrumentals, are what makes it so good. I love everything about the instrumental of the song. It perfectly gets that idea of loneliness across. And Dice Raw's hook, just that "and no one's in the lighthouse, your face down in the ocean" vocal is just it's fucking beautiful. It's impactful as hell. And it results in The Lighthouse being easily one of my favorite songs on the record, and easily one of my favorite songs The Roots has ever made. And in my opinion, it's just a beautiful fucking song and perfectly encapsulates what it wants to. We move on to the track I Remember, which, if I'm being very honest, this song is very special to me. And not only would I call this probably and pretty easily my favorite song off Undun, I'd comfortably call this my all-time favorite Roots song. It's not nearly as popular, and it's not, you know, the enjoyability of The Seed or the just funness of Adrenaline or what's the song, or the, like, just the nature of, I don't even describe how great You Got Me is, but what makes I Remember so beautiful to me is pretty much just everything about this idea of reflecting on your past and reflecting on mistakes you've made and letting those mistakes kind of destroy you on the inside. Pretty much from the first couple notes, I basically knew for myself, this song is going to really hit deep. And it is easily the most hard-hitting song, I think, on the whole record. The hook is done by Mercedes Martinez and Tracy Moore, and it is beyond beautiful. I wouldn't say the writing on the hook is incredible. I mean, the lyrics are, "I remember, do you remember how it was, I do remember to you." It's not, like, super boring, but at the same time, it's so beautifully sang, it's so well put together. At the end of the day, it results in me not really caring about the writing, because it's just a beautiful hook, and it perfectly encapsulates the song as a whole. But it's Black Thought's rapping and his emotion that I think really hits me. The first two verses kind of feel like him looking back, walking around, and just kind of seeing memories of his life and, like, very much regretting things that he's done. And it's very heavy on this theme of just regretting what you've done. I think the lyrics, there's the third verse, though. Let's talk about the third verse. Third verse is really where this song hits a very deep point for me, because it has these lyrics at the beginning of the verse that really, I think, tell a very deep theme and really give a clue as to why the suicide was committed. We do know really why. It's because of the crime that's affected him. But why did he push crime so hard? Well, we're kind of given this interesting thought here where he basically says, it's only human to express the way you really feel, but that same humanity is my Achilles heel. A leopard can't change its spots and never will, so I'm forever ill and I can never chill. This lyric is so heavy to me because it's basically him saying, I will not be weak and talk about my emotions because that will leave me vulnerable. And I am a broken person. I'm a leopard who can't change his spots, those spots metaphorically being the damage and the pain I am as a person. So I'm forever ill and I cannot come back from that. There is something that is so goddamn beautiful about this idea of looking at yourself. It's not beautiful, the idea of looking at yourself and thinking, like, there's no way I can reverse this. It's more this idea that's like, when you look at the record as a whole, if Redford had thought to himself, I can change. And he didn't go down this mentality of, I need to get more material wealth. It's arguable he would still, like, by the end of this record, or that there wouldn't be a suicide. Like, there wouldn't be an end for him. The idea of being unchangeable is a common idea in the world that leads a really dark path. Because part of the reason why depression is caused is self-hatred. And if you don't feel like you can stop being a person, a terrible person, then you don't feel like you deserve to live. Because if you're unchangeable, often it's very easy to interpret that as, I shouldn't be around. And also when you kind of have this mentality about, I'm a bad guy, I'm the villain, I'm unchangeable, you're only going to become worse. You're only going to destroy yourself worse. And Redford arguably does that, as he thinks to himself, I hate crime, I don't like this life, but I have to because I'm too broken to not do it. There is something that's so impactful about that idea. It really packs a huge punch to a song that has a beautiful instrumental, amazing vocals, and on top of that, just beautiful rapping, lyricism, and everything. And there's a good reason I would easily call this the most impactful and beautiful song that Roots have ever done, and I find I remember it to be the peak highlight of this album, and the song is overall just fucking amazing. Just fucking amazing. Tip the Scale acts as a very good outro and intro because it asks the questions that this album kind of wants to end itself on, but it does kind of set things off. The track feels kind of like it's this start of crime to him and his start to really push what he does as a criminal. Redford seems to be kind of living his life as a street criminal in this, and I don't know what the fuck this ad is, but it seems like he's really living his life as this dangerous street criminal. And he doesn't like this. He really would rather live a happy life. But he doesn't. He just kind of wants to end it all. He's feeling very suicidal. Which, this album, throughout almost the whole runtime, he does feel suicidal. Except for a couple tracks here and there. But his motivation kicks in. He doesn't give in. He has this courage to rise to the top and get out of this poverty he was pretty much born into. And it kind of leaves with a third-person perspective of, he is broke, he is poor, and that's kind of the opening motivation to push crime as heavy it is. Sure, there is that theme of covering up depression, but that depression is caused by the crime itself. What caused the crime itself? Wanting to get out of the dark place he was, in the dark neighborhood he was. And I really want to get into how, when we look at it, is Redford's mentality to chase crime bad? Like, does he make a mistake doing that? You could argue, yeah, he does make a mistake because it's what leads to death, but is it his fault? Really, at the end of the day, the song is beautiful to me. I love the Dice Raw hook once again. And the instrumental is amazing, and I love the theme of the track. But overall, I really think Tip the Scale kind of introduces this interesting question, because it says, okay, this is the mentality of Redford. Why does he go to this mentality? Well, the reason he goes to his mentality is because he has no other choice. And when someone has no other choice, can you blame them for not making a great decision? Now, the album ends with a four-act instrumental piece, and I'm not going to go through that because there's not a ton I feel like I can say. There's not like a ton I will really analyze in each track, but I will go through each piece. The first one is the track Redford for Yaya and Papa, which is originally by Solfin Stevens, released in 2003, and it's the entire inspiration behind the character Redford. This track is where that character came from. And it's a re-performance from Solfin Jane. It's not Solfin Stevens, it's not the original, but it's a beautiful song. It's a very nice track, and I love it overall. Knowing a Possibility, which is pretty much just a brief string quartet. Will to Power is the part three of this, and it's a free jazz performance by Questlove and Dee Dee Jackson. And it's interesting how kind of chaotic this track is. It's not nearly as emotional, like in the same mode as Redford and Possibility are. It's a lot more intense in that sense, and I think it adds a nice vibe and a nice sound in the last four tracks here. And the finality movement four ends on a somewhat abrupt note, but a very telling note. And it's another string quartet. I love the way the album ends off on finality. I think it's a beautiful way to end it. Questlove has described these last four tracks as kind of the circle of birth and death. And this is the part of the album I found the least analysis in. And it's not the problem of it. I think it's how deep it gets. Because it's very hard to analyze the music of an instrumental. It's hard to find the deep meaning there. But there's this theme of like life and birth and death. And it's the theme of the whole record. But in a lot of ways, I almost feel like these final tracks are kind of a wrap up of themes here. And really when it comes down to it, it's just a very impactful track in the way it kind of wants to go about it. But it leaves with a question, and it leaves Undun with a question. This is kind of where I really want to wrap my conclusion to. And that's basically this. Redford doesn't really seem to make a mistake, or he makes a mistake, but it's not his fault that he takes the path of crime. And that is because you can argue very well that Redford didn't have a choice. This wasn't a life he got to choose. He didn't choose to go down a crime path because he was born into a society that would hate him and push him towards that from the beginning. And that is basically what I feel like the roots Undun is going at. It's not going at this idea of don't do crime because you'll get suicidal. It's not doing that. This album is saying, look, let's take, you want to experience how depressing the idea is that systematic racism forces young black people to grow up and live their entire life thinking the only way I can get out is crime. And often it kind of can be in a world that rejects that culture so much. It's very fascinating that at the end of the day, it's an album that's basically saying, okay, you want to understand how depressing that is. Here's a character. Here is someone you can connect to. Hey, you're another human being. You have experienced ideas of loss and feeling depression and remorse. Look at how this kid's depression and remorse started. It started because he was told the only way he could get out was crime, because that is what society brought to him. That is what society was growing up in. You can even argue, there's this whole idea of destiny in this record, and Black Thought's talked about this, how the record, almost one of the big themes in it is, did Redford have his destiny set out by other people? Did he ever have a choice to not be a criminal and go down the dark path that led him to suicide? Was there ever even an option to do that? When, and you can think about it to yourself, oh yeah, yeah, he always could have chosen. But really, deep down, was he ever gonna know that he was, like, that there could be any other path for him? It really ends this album off in this just very lonesome but very thought-provoking idea. And part of the reason I say this album is still a masterpiece 10 years later, it's not just how phenomenal Black Thought's rhyme schemes are and storytelling and perspectives, or how amazing the instrumentals are, how amazing the vocals are, just how perfect the sound of the record is and the ideas of the record are. It is insane to me that even thematically, this record is still so fucking relevant. This idea that systematic racism forces black people to have their set goal out before they're even born, that is not a like unheard of theme. That's still a thing that we see continuously in music and even in the world in general. Because in a country that hates people before they're even born for something as simple as being a certain color of skin or in a certain culture, it's interesting the fact that this record said this 10 years ago and nothing changed. It's 2021. This album's been up for 10 years. And it is still, like, in no regard does this record lose its relevancy. And there's even a thought to me that makes me think, I kind of want Undun to age. Like, you wouldn't think that. You wouldn't think you want one of the greatest hip-hop records of all time to age. But as long as Undun's themes start becoming irrelevant, then when it comes down to it, Undun stops being, like, the problem Undun's facing stops being a real problem. And it's just, it's so fascinating to me how this, how you could have released this album today and nobody would have thought anything like, oh, this sounds old, or oh, this sounds like it should have come out in 2011. This album could have come out in 2021 and it would have had the same relevancy. I don't know if that's Black Thought having beautiful writing. It's more of the depressing thought that as a society, we haven't advanced. And as a country, we haven't advanced past the point Undun was written in. You can even go back farther than that, way farther than that. Go back to the 1970s when certain things were said about race, and the 60s even farther. And the fact that we still live in a country that hasn't really changed that mentality. it's slightly altered. You could say things in the 60s aren't the same, but the fact of the matter is things haven't really altered that much. And it makes me very depressed to see that this album still holds that relevancy. Sonically, I'm happy this album is as amazing as it is still today. But the fact that we're still in a state where the ideas of this record are very relevant, it's very depressing. Undun is, in my opinion, the best record the Roots have ever made and probably will ever make. Their themes on this record, their ideas on this record are so grand and deep, but they're so simple and they're not hard to understand. Nothing about this album is hard to comprehend. I do want to say I feel like this record influenced a lot of concept records, storytelling records. I'd say maybe something like To Pimp a Butterfly arguably could have been pretty influenced by Undun and other projects that have come out this decade. The Roots, the way they just worded and the way they put this album together, it's just a beautiful piece of hip-hop music to me, and I will forever find it to be one of my favorite records. It is an amazing album. I am very happy to celebrate its 10-year anniversary, and I do hope in its 20th anniversary, or even in the most best scenario, in its 21st anniversary, or 11th anniversary, Undun would not hold thematic relevancy, because it's very depressing to watch this album entire idea still hold up today. But what do you guys see Undun as? What are your interpretations? Are there other thoughts that I kind of missed that you want me to talk about? Go in the comment section below. Happy 10 years to Undun. I have other videos coming out. I'm going to review that French Montana thing. I heard it. It's awful. I would love to analyze the fuck out of it. There's also a new Brent Faiyaz, which I want to talk about, and new Polo G, which aren't out yet, but they'll be out tonight. So I think Polo G's out tonight, if I'm not wrong. See you guys next time. Peace out. Also, Roddy Ricch on the 17th, which I can't wait for. See you guys next time. Peace out. Go stream The Roots. Go stream Undun. It's a little bit of an underrated record, in my opinion. Probably one of my least known A-plus records, but I feel like it should be more known. See you guys next time. Peace out. Happy 10 years to Undun.